And our final speaker is joining us online. It's Nicole Madeo from the University of Toronto, and she'll be talking to us about evolutionary ecology of malaria transmission. Thanks, Nicole.
Hello. Can anyone confirm that you can actually hear me?
Yes.
Amazing. Thank you. I want to get like 5 minutes into my talk and then find out you've heard nothing. So thank you very much for the invitation to speak today and for letting me be here virtually. I certainly wish I was hanging out with more of you in person. Anyway, I'm going to talk about malaria transmission from the perspective of the parasite. And you'll see I'm really leaning into the theme of ecology and evolution today. So please bear with me as I do that. But I'm going to start with just some acknowledgements to let you know who I've done the work with that I'm going to talk about today. So these are the folks with whom I've done this work, in particular, Megan Grescher, who was a postdoc in my group and is now a prof at Cornell. And some of these faces will be familiar to you. We've got one of our fearless organizers of this meeting here on this slide. So you'll see some of these faces and names again throughout my talk. Okay, so I'm talking about malaria transmission, and it's weird for me to give a talk and not have to explain something about the malaria life cycle to the audience. But I assume everybody is familiar with this, you know, erythrocytic cycle of invasion, replication, and bursting, and then, you know, some fraction of those infected cells go on to produce gametocytes. And we often talk about that fraction as the conversion rate. So I might occasionally say conversion rate, or I might instead say transmission investment. And I mean the same thing. What fraction of infected cells are going on to produce these gametocytes that can be transmitted to mosquitoes? And the weird thing about malaria parasites is that they really invest very little in these transmission stages. So a few percent of infected cells are going on to produce these transmission stages. And from the perspective of an evolutionary ecologist, this problem that we have of having to invest some resources in asexual replication and some in gametocytes, this is a common problem in the tree of life. This is a resource allocation problem. And all sexually reproducing organisms face the same trade-off. How do you invest resources in growth and also reproduction? And of course, you know, from an evolutionary perspective, the reproduction part is really important. So for parasites, making new infections is like reproducing the infection. So there's this whole branch of theory in evolutionary ecology that deals with this problem of how do organisms balance resource allocation trade-offs. And so it was from this perspective that I came to this problem in malaria infections and wanted to answer the question, you know, why are malaria parasites investing so little in transmission? And of course, there were a bunch of hypotheses that were pervading the literature to try to explain this feature of malaria infections. So some of them include things like, well, maybe if you're investing too much in gametocytes, the host might generate a really strong transmission blocking immune response, or maybe it might lead to too much mosquito mortality. And so that either of those things could be bad from the perspective of the parasite getting transmitted onwards. So what feels like a million lifetimes ago now, I worked on this problem as a PhD student using sort of simple mathematical techniques to ask, you know, what should parasites do from an evolutionary perspective? They probably, you know, our metric of fitness for infections, like I said, is generating new infections. So R0 is one measure of the number of new infections generated by a single infection. And R0 is an expression that you can derive from a standard model of malaria transmission. So using mathematical tools, I asked, well, how do these different processes impact R0? Do they help parasites gain greater fitness? You know, if parasites are investing less in gametocytes, does that help them gain greater fitness given these different processes? And what you can show mathematically is actually neither of these hypotheses, neither mosquito mortality nor transmission blocking immunity, can generate selection for low investment in gametocytes. What they can do is generate selection for low numbers of gametocytes, but that's not the same thing. And I'll just show you a cartoon to try to explain why that's not the same thing. So if we just reduce an infection to essentially a bag of blood, we can ask, so these hypotheses might say that, you know, a low number of gametocytes is good for parasites. Let's just make two gametocytes. That's the best thing to do in my cartoon example. Here's a case where parasites have infected 8 red blood cells and they've converted a quarter of those infected red blood cells to gametocytes. But of course, there are a number of other ways of getting two gametocytes in this bag of blood scenario. You could infect fewer red blood cells and convert more of them, or even fewer and convert more of them. So these particular hypotheses can't generate selection for low investment in gametocytes, which is what we actually see, but they can generate selection for a low number of gametocytes. So those hypotheses don't really do the job. What we found mathematically is that co-infection, when parasite genotypes share their host with another parasite genotype, that can actually generate selection for low investment in gametocytes. And this is because the parasites that do well in competition are the ones that exploit more resources. And so you can imagine that spending more time in this cycle of invading red blood cells, generating more of these asexual parasites, is going to get you more resources as a parasite. And it leads you to outcompete any competitors in a co-infection. So that was a sort of theoretical prediction, which was then tested in Sarah's lab. So this was work done by Laura Pollitt, who was then a PhD student. This is showing you a measure of transmission investment on the y-axis over the course of infections for two different rodent malaria parasite genotypes in the different colors. And in the solid lines are what parasites are doing when they're by themselves in infections. And then the dashed lines are showing you what the parasites do when they're in a co-infection. And so what you can see is that parasites seem to be reducing their investment in transmission when they're in competition with another parasite genotype. So they're doing what we predicted by the theory. Another thing you might notice from these data is that transmission investment seems to vary over the course of an infection. This is a plastic trait. It can change in response to stuff that's happening in an infection. And so further work, future work led by Megan Grescher, who she started this work when she was a PhD student. She was really interested in those sort of plastic patterns of investment over the course of an infection. And she wanted to model, like she wanted to predict, what are the best patterns of investment? What should parasites be doing if they're behaving optimally over the course of an infection? So to answer that question, we had to develop mechanistic models of within host infection dynamics. So I'm not going to say much about these models, but you know, there's some supply of red blood cells in the infection. Those red blood cells might get infected, take some number of days to complete their cycle, and then a fraction of those infected cells go on to produce gametocytes, which take some time to develop. So this fraction of infected cells that are being invested in transmission, this is the key trait that we're trying to model. And so Megan and her work let this parameter, the C, be a function of time. She wanted to let it vary over time. I'm not going to show you the model. I, for some reason, have one equation up here just to let anyone know in the audience who's interested in the details. This was a delay differential equation model. And I'm just showing you the equation that's tracking gametocyte densities over time. So the model spits out dynamics like this. Here I'm showing you what happens if you assume there's a constant transmission investment. So that's not time varying, but every day 5% of infected cells are being converted into gametocytes. So what we do here to focus on parasite fitness is we take this trajectory of gametocyte densities over time, and we translate those gametocyte densities into an estimate of the probability of infecting mosquitoes. This is a curve that's derived from empirical data. And so at low gametocyte densities, you are very unlikely to infect a mosquito. And then you get this sort of saturating curve at high gametocyte densities. So we used numerical optimization tools to determine the investment strategies that maximize the cumulative probability of transmission. So each day, there is some probability of transmission to mosquitoes given a particular gametocyte density, and we essentially sum that up over the course of an infection. I'm going to show you sort of what this process looks like. So transmission investment again on the y-axis, days post-infection on the x-axis. Megan used flexible splines to define these transmission investment patterns. So here's one candidate pattern for transmission investment over time. And this purple bar here is giving you a measure of the fitness of that strategy. So the cumulative transmission potential of that strategy. So you'll see here the algorithm working through a bunch of different splines. You can see there's some pretty big fitness gains from reducing transmission investment early. And eventually you'll see that flexible curve flip back up near the end of the infection. We're modeling here a 20-day infection, And there's some gains to be had by increasing transmission investment before the end of that infection. Okay, so we're looking for the strategy that gives the best fitness return, that gives the highest cumulative transmission potential. And this is what that strategy looks like. So how should parasites invest in transmission over the course of an infection? This is what our model says parasites should do. And I'll point out a few key features. One, delaying transmission investment is important early on in the infection. Densities are so low, parasite densities are so low, that if you start converting those to gametocytes, you're going to have a very low probability of infecting a mosquito. So doing that is basically a waste of resources. So parasites do better by investing in that asexual biomass, by building up the infection and then turning on conversion so that you're turning it on at a higher level and you have a better chance of actually transmitting to mosquitoes with that number of gametocytes. Over the course of infection, the fluctuations in resource availability can modulate the value of investing in transmission. So that's why we see these sort of ups and downs. And then at the very end, because we're modeling essentially a 20-day infection, if parasites essentially know in our model that the infection is ending, then the best thing for parasites to do would be to turn all of the infected cells into transmission stages right before the infection ends. Obviously, that's a little bit of a contrived scenario, but that's why you see that rise to very high values at the end. One thing that Megan's models show, she looked at the effect of co-infection again, and she finds this exact same pattern that in co-infections, the best thing to do is reduce transmission investment over the course of the infection. So this is a prediction that survived multiple rounds of mathematical analysis and also an experimental analysis. So we think this is a pretty robust feature. We've used Megan's model to do a few different things. One of them is to look at the influence of processes that are happening at other scales. So this is a paper, I'm not gonna talk about the details, but I'm gonna tell you some of the take-home points. So we basically were trying to compare the effects of processes on other scales compared to what we know happens within a host, where we have this competition. Competition can generate this very strong selection for reduced investment. We looked at, like I said, processes at other scales, and we found that things like host recovery, declining mosquito populations, and growing epidemics all increase the value of early infectiousness. We're exploring whether population dynamics of mosquitoes or the epidemiological dynamics of the infection can actually influence selection on this trait that's expressed within the host. And we find that it can, and what it does is it actually favoring early infectiousness, to achieve earlier infectiousness, you actually have to reduce transmission investment. And it's for that same reason that I said before, reduced transmission investment leads to the infection growing faster. And so then you can actually achieve earlier infectiousness by turning on transmission investment at some point once you have a really high number of parasites within the infection. We've also used this modeling approach to investigate the impact of drug treatment on transmission investment strategies. So basically we wanted to know, can altering transmission investment help parasites evade the effects of drugs? And the reason why we thought it should, going to the sort of godfather of drug resistance and malaria, Nick White, although I could have gone to Anna. Anna said this in her talk too, higher replication rate might allow parasites to evade the effects of drugs. From Nick White's paper, he points out initial biomass influences the success of drug treatments. So again, investing more in asexual replication gives you a bigger biomass, which might help parasites evade the effects of drugs. So we took this, best transmission investment strategy that we defined theoretically, and we basically said, if you drug treat this infection at some point in time, say day 10, if we drug treat at day 10, what should parasites do? How should parasites respond in terms of their transmission investment? What's the best strategy basically in this magnifying glass? And does that best strategy depend on the drug dose that the host is given? We know what should happen in the face of no drugs. That's what we've defined before. So we're gonna compare the best strategies in the face of drugs with the best strategy when there's no drugs. So this is showing you for different drug doses, what should parasites do? What's the optimal transmission investment strategy right after that drug treatment? This green dot is the best strategy when there is no drugs in the host. As we increase the drug dose that the host is given, we see this reduction in transmission investment, and we call this reproductive restraint. So parasites are investing less in transmission, more in those asexual stages, which might help them, might help some of them overcome the effects of drug treatment. At some point, when the drug dose gets high enough, you see the reverse pattern, where actually this blue dot is higher than the green dot, meaning that parasites are investing more in transmission. We've called it terminal investment here, even though it's not quite at one, it is higher investment in transmission, when the drug dose is quite high. So in terms of the outcomes for parasites, at high drug doses, increasing transmission investment here in this blue dot provides a small fitness benefit. At this point, you know, if there's enough drugs in the system, the parasites are suffering a lot and they can't actually do much to overcome that effect. But big gains are seen at these intermediate drug doses, where decreasing transmission investment provides a really huge fitness benefit, which we actually quantify in the model. So this reproductive restraint can be really good for the parasites. And of course, what's good for the parasites is going to be bad for the hosts. Investing more in asexual replication, generating more of those host-damaging asexual parasites is not good. And our measure of fitness here is, you know, generating new infections. So this is also going to have an epidemiological cost as well. This was another theoretical prediction that Sarah and her group were able to test. So this was experimental work led by Petra Schneider. The x-axis is a bit different. They used different drug doses, but converted those drug doses into an estimate of the proportion of parasites killed. And what Petra found is that parasites do, again, what the theory is predicting, that as you increase the proportion of parasites killed by drugs, you see this reduction in transmission investment until you get to a certain point, and then the pattern seems to flip over, as was predicted by the theory. Okay, one last thing I want to tell you about. This is work that's in progress, so it's, my thoughts on it are not fully formed. Really happy to get any feedback on it, but it's something that we're really excited about, which is thinking about the cues that parasites are actually using to adjust transmission investment. Everything we've done so far, we've been defining these strategies as a function of time, because it's mathematically pretty convenient to do that. It's computationally pretty convenient to do that, but probably malaria parasites are not keeping track of time. So this is work that's actually led by this amazing undergrad who's working in my lab. She's a third year student and she's just like bad. She's amazing. Anyway, so she's taken a mechanistic model. It's a little bit different actually than the model that Megan developed, and I'm happy to talk about any of the details. But here, instead of transmission investment being a function of time, Avril makes transmission investment a function of some other variable. And she's tried a whole bunch. After listening to Christelle's talk, I realize maybe we should also think about age structure of red blood cells. Basically, we've looked at red blood cells, infected red blood cells, either all of them or ones that are harboring asexually committed parasites or sexually committed parasites. We've looked at gametocytes, and then we've looked at all of these variables either on their raw scale or on their log scale. I suspect some of you might be thinking, what about lyso-PC? Isn't that just the answer? So obviously this model is not written at that level of mechanistic detail. I'd also put it to you that lyso-PC, if that's a resource that parasites are using to replicate, then one of these other measures like infected red blood cells, some variant of infected red blood cells, maybe the asexually committed ones, that lyso-PC should be a proxy for that other sort of ecological variable. So essentially what Avril was doing was, taking these transmission investment strategies as a function of this environmental variable, and then using splines again to define those, what we would call reaction norms in evolutionary ecology. So again, we're fitting different splines, asking what's the best spline, what's the best transmission investment pattern for a given cue, and then we can compare, the fitness returns of using those different cues. So this is those fitness returns. Again, we're looking at the cumulative transmission potential of different cues. Avril's stacked them according to their rank. And what you can see, a couple things to point out here. This I think is quite interesting. These logged parasite density cues actually outperform their raw values. So in some sense, parasites do better if they ignore raw values and think only about the logged values. I think that's interesting. Biologically, that makes a little bit of sense. We know in rodent malaria that if you want to see different infection dynamics, you have to alter the dose by an order of magnitude. I think there might be a little bit of a technical constraint going on here too, the way the splines work. When you look at raw values, so this is showing you the best transmission investment patterns for looking at total infected red blood cells or the logged values, because of the way the smoothness of the splines work, you can't get something that's super steep. You can't get something that sort of ignores low values and then turns on really strongly as the values reach you know, some sort of threshold. You can get the steepness when you looked at the logged values, but not the raw values. Just two more things to say. I see my clock winding down. When we looked at these transmission investment patterns, so the parasites are using some environmental cue, but we can ask, given the infection dynamics, what does the conversion rate pattern look like over time? And Avril's colored the best strategies, and then in gray are strategies that are not so good. All of the best strategies have the same delayed investment in transmission that we saw with the time varying strategies. So again, I think that's really important. Last thing to say, what we've done so far is looked at single cues, but it seems quite obvious that multiple cues are going to be important for parasites. Any given cue is going to have this feature where you can get the same value of that cue in very different situations for the parasite. So going up in this parasite density curve is a much better position for parasites to be in than on the way back down. So Avril is working on what happens if you have what are the best cues to look at if you can integrate multiple cues in a system. It's a really technically challenging problem, and I'm like super excited that she is working on that. Okay. Just to sum up, hopefully I've showed you that life history theory can be usefully applied to malaria parasites, since they too are facing resource allocation trade-offs like all sexually reproducing organisms. We've shown many different ways that within host competition generates strong selection for reduced investment in transmission. Adjusting transmission investment can help parasites mitigate the effects of drugs to some extent. And then finally, models can help us elucidate the cues that parasites should use to adjust transmission investment. I think this is useful to do because, you know, we can look at what we know from empirical systems, what we know from the lab, and where these things don't match up, we can, you know, reveal constraints on parasite biology. But also, you know, from my own perspective, these cue-based models are really important for being able to make predictions about how parasites will respond to perturbations. We can't really make those predictions in over long terms without knowing what parasites are responding to. So I will stop there, and I'd be very happy to take any questions if there's time.
Thank you, Nicole. That was great. Ian, any question?
Really great talk.
Thanks.
For your drug resistance models, do you model drugs being equally effective against gametocytes and asexuals?
That's a great question. So the way that we did the models that I presented, I think if I recall correctly, the drugs are acting, the drugs are not acting on gametocytes. Sarah is in the room and she can give you more information. We were using a model of pyrimethamine drug treatment. I think we just focused on the drugs were not killing the gametocytes. When this undergrad Avril started working in my lab, this was the question we were gonna look at. We were gonna explore different kinds of drug treatment acting on different parasite stages. Because someone always asks me this question and I don't have an answer for like how different modes of drug action would impact transmission investment. I think it will impact transmission investment. Anyway, that was the question we were gonna answer. And then we went down this like totally different track, realizing that, yeah, thinking about the cues is probably a nice place to start. And then hopefully if we have time, we'll get back to the different drug modes of action. So I don't have an answer for you. We ignored any killing action on gametocytes in what I've showed you.
And you kind of answered my follow-up question in your
response.
So thank you very much.
Cool, thanks.
Hey, Nicole, great talk. Just to follow up on the drug too, because at least in falciparum, most drugs that kill asexuals will also kill immature gametocytes. Now, when they're mature, that is very often very different. But at least, you know, in the early, you know, 2 days after commitment, most of them are still susceptible to many of the schizontocytes. In your model, what is the effect of the length it takes for gametocytes to develop? Have you ever looked at that?
Oh, that's a good question. It's a good question. And I don't think I have an answer for you. You know, we have looked at Megan Grescher's models. You know, she's parameterized them for both rodent malaria and human malaria, and obviously lots of things differ, but one of the things that differs is that like the developmental time of gametocytes. We haven't looked at, if you just altered development time, what would be the response. So I don't have an answer for you. I will say Megan's model is one of same cycle commitment. So infected red blood cells, you know, the transmission investment strategy determines what fraction of those infected red blood cells at this time go on to produce gametocytes and asexuals. Avril's model, you know, she reading a bit more deeply in the literature, noticing that like nobody believes same cycle commitment is a thing. Next cycle commitment is a thing. So she's actually altered the model. So there's actually a time delay in Avril's model compared to Megan's model. She allows this extra cycle of asexual replication of parasites that are already sexually committed. And what that does is just delay all of the patterns by a day. She gets the exact same answer as Megan's model, but shifted in time. So I don't know that completely answers your question, but that's as far as we've done on that front.
Hi, nice talk. Your model about within host competition implies that the parasite can identify that some of its neighbors are of a different genotype. Can you speculate of how can they do this? If sometimes they perhaps vary on only a small number of antigens?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I don't know the answer to that. So Sarah's lab has done a lot of work in this area. And yeah, the parasites seem pretty smart. They're able to differentiate like changes in density from changes in like the characteristics of those parasites in the population. So they can definitely differentiate kin and non-kin. I don't know how they do that. You know, maybe it's this vesicles thing. Maybe they're sending information that way somehow. I don't know what folks in the audience think about that stuff. I've always been interested in like how different do the parasites have to be for them to consider each other non-kin. You know, like in the cycle of invasion, replication, and birth, the mutations are accumulating presumably in those parasite lineages. So at what point, if you start with a clonal infection, at what point would parasites be sufficiently different that they'd be like not kin anymore? Presumably it depends on, the answer to that question depends on, you know, what it is that they're recognizing as being different. And I feel like this is the audience that might have an answer to this question or might have more insight on that question. I don't know. I think parasites are smart.
Thanks for your talk, Nicole. I want to ask you where you had explored how your models might change under different scenarios of immunity.
Yeah.
Like how the model behaves with zero immunity, partial immunity, asymptomatic infection.
Yeah, great question. So what we've done on that front, so the Megan Grescher's model that I presented has no immunity in it. The baseline model has no immunity. So those patterns of transmission investment are in the face of no immunity. In her 2016 paper, she looks at what happens if you have a saturatable immune response. So some sort of innate immune response that can respond, but can be overwhelmed by parasite density. So thinking early on in an infection. And in that case, that sort of saturating immune response generate selection for even lower investment in transmission. So that's one thing. Avril's model, what we've been working on is a more complicated model that has two different kinds of immune responses in it. And this is from some of the other within host modeling work that I've done with other folks just to think about infection dynamics. So the model that we're working with now has an immune response that targets infected red blood cells and at this point, it's targeting both asexually and sexually committed infected red blood cells. And there's another immune response that is indiscriminate killing of all red blood cells. And we've parameterized it based on model fits to other rodent malaria data. So our current models have some immunity in them. We have the opportunity, I guess, to like turn on and off different components of that immunity and look at the consequences for transmission investment. And we haven't done that yet. Great suggestion.
Okay, one last quick one.
Sure.
Thanks for a very nice talk. I think your model very nicely show how this delay in commitment is important for the parasite. But I was wondering if I know it correctly, YVAX is committing straight coming out of the liver. So they apparently didn't read your model.
Interesting.
Can you speculate why that is?
I mean, can I speculate? I could speculate. That's one of my favorite things to do. So, I mean, you know, like Christelle's talk points out, you know, they have slightly different resource preferences. So that might have something to do with something. Or maybe they're doing something that is, so maybe there's an adaptive explanation for why that strategy would be quite different. I don't know what it is. It could be that it's a non-adaptive strategy and it's, you know, just a constraint of the system. I think, again, understanding, thinking about the cues will get us closer to being able to say, you know, like, are these parasites doing something that is good for them, or is it not? Could they have been doing something better? I'm gonna write that down because I didn't know that about Vivax, and I will think harder about it.
Yeah, I would suggest that because they can't outgrow falciparum, so they try to out-transmit it.
That's a great point. In places where you have both of them circulating, that makes sense. Thank you.
Okay. We can speculate some more after the session. I'd like to thank Nicole and all the speakers. Thank you very much.